Good evening, everyone. Good evening. I'm Harold Holzer, director of the Roosevelt House, and as always, it's a pleasure to welcome all of you to what is essentially, I guess, the first of our evening public programs to mark Women's History Month. March is Women's History Month, and please remember that part of the celebration is the opportunity for you to have another look, or perhaps your first look, at the exhibition of women's suffrage material that we have on view upstairs. I was going to say only through the end of the month. We'll be announcing an extension, but don't let that deter you from seeing it soon again and often. Well, tonight we're going to welcome two extraordinary women who will be speaking about two extraordinary women. And it's a real pleasure to welcome both of them to the home of Eleanor Roosevelt, who played such a big role in Pauli Murray's courageous and groundbreaking life of activism. As the book we are gathered here to discuss, The Firebrand and the First Lady, has really made clear for the first time. And it's a particular pleasure to welcome everyone here to Pauli Murray's alma mater, Hunter College. Pauli Murray was Phi Beta Kappa, Hunter class of 1933, January 1933. She couldn't wait. And that was only one of the many milestones in a life we will hear about this evening. And as I think you know, and as the book shows, Pauli Murray played a hugely significant role in the life of Eleanor Roosevelt. They had an intellectual and politically intense friendship that lasted from the 1930s until Mrs. Roosevelt's death in 1962. You will hear all about Pauli Murray, her activism later. She was a co-founder of the National Organization for Women, and it's really an extraordinary life. I'll leave the rest of the story to our guests, or the particular story about Pauli Murray and Mrs. Roosevelt. Our guests: Patricia Bell-Scott is Professor Emerita of Women's Studies and Human Development and Family Science at the University of Georgia, and a major chronicler of Black women's lives, including her book Double Stitch, Black Women Write About Mothers and Daughters, which won the Letitia Woods Brown Memorial Book Prize. I hope some of you saw the book review, the New York Times book review a couple of weeks ago, in which Irene Carmone, who some of you remember, came to see us at Hunter a few months ago, the author of the notorious RBG, the co-author, had high praise for The Firebrand and the First Lady. She noted that nothing was ever easy for Pauli Murray, a Black woman born in 1910, a woman attracted to women, and also a poet, memoirist, lawyer, activist, and Episcopal priest. But her tender friendship with Roosevelt, sustained over nearly a quarter century and more than 300 cards and letters, helped. It is the rich earth Patricia Bell-Scott tills for The Firebrand and the First Lady, a tremendous book that has been 20 years in the making. I think that's what we authors call a rave. And the value of the time you spent shines on every page, Professor. Thank you for your book, and thank you for being here today to celebrate its publication in the home of one of your protagonists. In conversation with Professor Bell-Scott is Nell Irvin Painter, the Edwards Professor of American History Emerita at Princeton University and one of the most esteemed historians of recent decades. She has written many books that have shaped our understanding of African American history and American history since she published her first book, Exodusters, Black Migration to Kansas After Reconstruction, in 1976. Her most recent book, The History of White People, was published in 2010, and its influence was immediate and has only been growing. I met Professor Painter, I thought it was just a few years ago, but I'm told authoritatively that it was 19 years ago, when she's still young, I'm a wreck, but when she delivered the Fortenbaugh lecture on Abraham Lincoln at Gettysburg College. It was a while ago. Since her retirement from Princeton, Nell has embarked on a post-historian's career as an acclaimed visual artist that, as far as I know, has been equaled by only a couple of people that I can think about. Winston Churchill, maybe, and George W. Bush. The second act in American art. But you should know that on her website, this great historian now identifies herself as Nell Painter, the painter formerly known as the historian Nell Painter. I think that's pretty good. And I got it out. I rehearsed it a lot. I'm thrilled we were able to bring her here from Princeton to Roosevelt House. Please welcome Professors Patricia Bell-Scott and Nell Irvin Painter.
Would you like to say something about Pauline Murray before we start?
I'd like to say how pleased I am to be here at this event hosted by an institution that's part of her alma mater. Hunter was very important to Pauline. She came here in 1928 after having graduated from a small high school in the South that only went to the 11th grade, which meant that she had to come to New York and earn a second high school diploma so that she could be admitted into Hunter. And if you've read her autobiography, what you know is that Hunter, of all the institutions she approached during a weekend here, was the one place where she found acceptance and encouragement. And so she did come to Hunter. Pauline had all kinds of financial trouble, so that she did drop out after her sophomore year, but she eventually returned. And one of the things that she always remembered and would credit Hunter for were her relationships with two professors here. One was a Catherine Reingart, who was an English professor, who encouraged Pauline to write. Pauline had always wanted to write. As I was saying to my colleague here, Nell, but we know Pauline primarily as an activist, as the first African-American woman to be ordained as an Episcopal priest. But the thing that she wanted to be known as primarily, or first and foremost, I should say, was as a writer. And it was in Catherine Reingart's class that she wrote an essay that contained the seeds of the family memoir, Proud Shoes. And she would always be grateful for that professor for encouraging her. She also made lifelong friends here with whom she maintained contact throughout her life. So it was a very important experience for her to come to Hunter. So I'm grateful that she came because it helped make Pauline who she became.
All right, well, hello. Nice to see you all. Thank you. I have several questions, so I will pose these questions to Professor Bell-Scott, and she will talk to them or ignore them as she prefers. And then as we get toward the end, there'll be time for you to ask some questions as well. This is an extraordinary book of two extraordinary women. And when you think about, when you think about the times that we're in now, and you think about those two women, and we kind of want things to get better as they go along. I'm not sure that's what's happened. But I think we're in a time that asks us to keep both times in mind, our own time and their times. No, we have three times going on because you worked on this book for a very long time. So I'm going to ask you about your involvement as a writer, as a scholar, as a person attracted to these women as human beings. Did you have any idea of what you'd be finding when you began this project?
No. I began with one question, which led to several questions. But the first question was, how is it that the daughter, the granddaughter of a mixed slave from North Carolina, and a woman whose ancestry entitled her to membership in the Daughters of the American Revolution, what drew these two women together? I was very curious about this unlikely friendship. So that got me started. And then once I opened that door, I became interested in the relationship long term. I wanted to know, what were the dynamics of this friendship? You know, what did each bring to this relationship? And because it was a long relationship, I wanted to know, how did it change over time? And I also, and because I was looking at time, I wanted to look at the historical backdrop. So that what that meant was, not only was I looking at what was happening with each woman individually, I was looking at them within historical context. So that the curtain behind which this story unfolds is a curtain where we're looking at the Depression, we're looking at World War II, we're looking at McCarthyism, we're looking at several major historical events and historical movements, early civil rights, the beginning of the modern day women's movement, more contemporary version of the women's movement. And each of these women had a role to play in all of those movements, and each was affected as an individual by these historical moments. So I was trying to look at each individual woman, I was looking at the historical context, and I was looking at over time. And then as I continued with the project, it occurred to me that it would probably be useful to readers for me to try to make some assessment about the impact of this friendship for the cause of social justice, which was the passion that they shared, the cause of social justice and human rights. And so I ended up with four questions. What drew these two unlikely women together in friendship? What was the nature of the friendship? What was the chemistry? How did they sustain the relationship? How did it change over time? And what significance did it have for the cause of social justice and human rights?
I'm going to ask the audience, how many of you have had a chance to read this book yet? Okay, not just one heroine there. So you're going to have to answer those questions.
Well, one of the first things that I learned was, despite the fact that they came from very different backgrounds, and the fact that Pauli was 26 years junior to Eleanor Roosevelt, they had a lot in common, more than you might have imagined. First of all, they were both child orphans. They both lost their parents when they were very young. They were both raised by elderly kin. They had some personality characteristics in common. People are often shocked to hear me say that they were both innately shy because they seemed bigger than life. I mean, when you say Eleanor Roosevelt, people think of a really courageous woman. And if you know anything about Pauli, people tend to think that see her as a really brave woman, and she was. But they were both innately shy. They both had tremendous energy. They would wear out their best friends. However, they both suffered from low moods, anxiety, feelings of insecurity. They were people who, for whom their overall sense of well-being depended in large measure on having what they considered to be meaningful work. So work was really important for their sense of well-being, as well as company with their cherished friends. And cherished friends included their dogs. So for Eleanor, that was typically, she had a preference for Scottish Terriers, and we about Bala, and yes. but there were other, Terriers that she had. And Pauli had a soft spot for strays and large mutts. Mm-hmm. So dogs were really, they always had dogs. So they had that in common. They were lifelong Episcopalians. And I think it's important not to discount that commonality in terms of their faith. They were devoted, lifelong Episcopalians. And Pauli, even though she had challenges with the church and left briefly from time to, at least twice, because she was upset with the treatment of women, always came back. And Pauli was a sixth generation Episcopalian. So this was a really important connection that they had. They were both avid readers. They loved to write. They loved poetry. They loved reading poetry aloud to friends. So there was a tremendous amount of commonality in these two women that is not apparent when one thinks of them. So I was really surprised and interested to learn how much they had in common. I also, the second question had to do with how did they sustain this relationship, and they sustained it through letters primarily. However, they supplemented those letters with candy. They would send each other flowers when one was sick or feeling low. And they did get together from time to time. Pauli first saw Eleanor Roosevelt at Camp Tara in the fall of 1934. And it was a very dramatic experience for Pauli because Eleanor showed up behind the wheel of her convertible coupe. She's the driver. The passengers are Malvina Tommy Thompson, her private secretary, a man Pauli took to be a Secret Service agent, though my research suggests that this man was probably Tommy's husband. He was probably not. Eleanor didn't like having Secret Service around. And so she showed up at this camp, which was the first camp for unemployed women. It was sort of a female version of the CCC camps. However, Eleanor was determined that unlike the CCC camps for men, this particular camp would not be segregated. That was really important to her. And since it was a pet project of hers and it was not very located very far from her home, it was in the Bear Mountain area of New York, she would go periodically unannounced to inspect the camp to see how things were going. So she drives up in this convertible coupe, gets out of the car, and immediately starts going through the premises. And the camp residents are really excited, and they are following her. But Pauli, who is shy and stunned by this unannounced appearance of the First Lady, and Eleanor hasn't been First Lady that long, is sitting in a corner in the social hall, which is the dining area of Camp Terria, and peering at Eleanor furtively behind a newspaper. She's too shy to speak and too shy to introduce herself. So there isn't a direct interaction there, but I want to believe that Eleanor saw her because Eleanor made a practice of counting the number of women of color she saw. She was determined that the camp be integrated. And so she would periodically count and make a note, and whenever she thought she saw something that wasn't quite right, would write the camp director. 4 years later, Pauli applied to the University of North Carolina's graduate school. And within weeks of her application, the president, Franklin Roosevelt, went to the campus to speak. And his address was shortly after the midterm elections. It was a widely anticipated address. People were very excited. Arrangements were made to broadcast the speech internationally. And Franklin Roosevelt heaped all kinds of praise on the university for its liberalism, for its faith in youth, for its progressive attitude on all fronts. And Pauli was beside herself because she knew that they didn't accept black students, But she had hoped her application would be accepted anyway, and it was not. And when she read the transcript of the president's speech in the New York Times, she was living in New York, in Harlem at the time, she just could not sit still. So she, with her trusty typewriter, began a 3-page single-spaced letter, which she sent to the president, calling him to task for his praise of the university and the university's policy, which forbid the admission of black students, forbid the hiring of black professional staff in any capacity. And she sent this hot letter to the president, but as she was getting that letter ready to go, she thought, well, you know, he has a maze of secretaries. It may not make it through. Perhaps I might send a copy of this to Eleanor with a cover, which is what she did. Now, the president's office forwarded Pauli's letter to the Office of Education, and they responded about a month later. But Eleanor wrote back promptly over her own signature, and in that letter, she said, you know, I understand, I'm paraphrasing because I don't have it right in front of me, but she said that I understand your concerns, but I want you to know that great change is coming, and it's best to fight in conciliatory ways, but don't push too fast. There was this caution, don't push too fast. And Pauli was very happy to get this letter from Eleanor. However, she was not about to accept the advice that she needed to slow down or be more patient. So this was symbolic of the relationship in the early stages when the relationship first began. Pauli, the impatient youth, unwilling to compromise and very anxious for dramatic social change, and Eleanor Roosevelt, first lady of the nation, feeling very much that her role was to be supportive of her husband's measured approach on the question of civil rights. And so there's this tension of Pauli wanting to, let's go, let's get moving, and Eleanor saying, let's not move too fast. Now, this is in 1938. By the time Eleanor dies, and Pauli's also very suspicious and unwilling to ever vote for Franklin Roosevelt, by the time Eleanor is in her final years, Pauli has moved. This tells you a little bit, I'm foreshadowing, tell you a little bit about the dramatic impact of the friendship. Pauli moves from being someone who could never vote for Franklin Roosevelt, who is suspicious of the two-party system, to becoming a registered voting Democrat. And Eleanor moves from taking the position of one who says you don't push too fast and you need to work within the system and you must obey laws that require segregated seating and segregated accommodations until those laws are passed. She moves from that position to actively supporting civil rights activists who are disobeying segregation codes in the Southern South. So what finally happens is, I can't ever say that Pauli moves to the center. She moves toward the center. She's always left of center. And Eleanor moves from the middle a little to the left. So we see them converging politically. So that was just one example of how the relationship changed over time. And on the question of what impact did it have for the nation, I dare to say that had it not been for that relationship, I don't know if Pauli, and this may be too strong, but this is just my speculation, would have been willing to work within the system that allowed her to work with Betty Friedan to found the National Organization for Women. Pauli agreed to serve on the President's Commission for the Status of Women in 1961, where she worked with a group that was looking at the question of the Equal Rights Amendment. She became someone who decided that it was worth the discomfort to learn to try to work within bureaucracies, bureaucracies always tried her. She had a really hard time. And the people who were the mainstays of those bureaucracies always found her difficult. Like, for example, the NAACP, you know. And I also think that's another reason why we don't know as much as about her, because often when people write the history of various movements, they write the history of those organizations which have been at the forefront of that movement. And so we have nice histories of Walter White, and there's even a new book about Thurgood Marshall and people who were, well, Thurgood was her peer, people who worked within bureaucracies. And there is a tendency to see the institutional leaders as the most important people. And so what I'm hoping is that this will get people interested in Pauli and look at, because I couldn't possibly cover all facets of her life, but to open that door. Now that's a long response to four questions.
Yeah. I was going to ask you what you thought your book would contribute to American historiography when you began. And I think you may have answered that. But let me ask you anyway. When, you know, you're just starting out, you're just thinking about these two women whom you evidently then thought of as very different. It sounds like as you wrote, you brought them closer together on personal terms, perhaps, less on their sociological trappings, but more on their personal psychological likenesses. So I'm guessing that when you began, you thought this was going to be a book about activism and women working together as activists. Now that you've finished the book after such a long time, and since you've gotten such a warm response, what do you think this book is doing?
That's an interesting question. One of the things that I hope the book does is adds to the interest and the fuel to look at women's friendships. I think that one of the reasons why this friendship has not been explored, because the documents have been there. It's not like I found new documents. Pauli has a huge archive. But the Roosevelt historians, some who've looked at Pauli have only mentioned this friendship in passing. And I felt like it deserved more attention than previous historians and biographers had given it. And it's also been my experience that that women who are as complex and complicated as Pauli raise such a challenge for us as scholars. I mean, I wear a historian's cap. I wear the cap of someone who has good grounding in social psychology and other disciplines, and it has taken all of that to try to look at this relationship, because Pauli is African-American. She was a political radical. She was a woman whose primary intimate affection was with women. She was a religious progressive, always a religious progressive. She was an aspiring writer, and I really think her writing needs to be evaluated. I think she needs more to get more credit there. So it was an interdisciplinary, much more complicated story than I had anticipated. And and I think that's something I would like other historians to consider.
Why do you think it was more complicated than you expected? Professor Bell-Scott is a social psychologist and has worked in women's studies, and you were part of all the feminists there wide and all the, give me the proper title of that.
All the women of white, all the blacks and me, the Some of us are brave.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So you knew, mm-hmm. at least on some level, that this is going to be a complicated story. Yet, as you were getting into it, you were surprised. Was that because of the way we grow up in the United States, thinking of ourselves in little boxes? Is it because it's hard to think of a person who's black or a person who's a feminist having so much psychological, I was going to say baggage, but we all, so much psychology. How's that?
Yes, is the answer to to all of that, in addition to the fact that this is a brilliant woman. Polly is absolutely brilliant. And the in sociological terms, there is just data overload, because she made meaning out of her life through writing. And by that I mean, she always kept journals. So she was, whether she was writing poetry or just writing notes about her life, there's just a huge amount of data, material, primary sources when one is trying to access exactly where she, you know, where her thinking was at a particular moment in life. So there's a huge amount of data. Also, for me, even though she was born in 1910 and I was born in 1950, there's a difference in historical moments. So here I am trying not to bias the work by looking only through the lens of my life. It wasn't, even though I've read and studied McCarthyism, it wasn't until I began to read Pauli's journal entries about her fears that McCarthyism really, I felt like I could just feel it. I mean, I remember reading a letter that she wrote to a friend where she had learned that members of the FBI had been up to her alma mater looking for information about her, had been to Howard. And she, this was in the 50s, and she was just petrified. I mean, but you know what she did? She was right about this. She knew that very frequently the information in those files is incorrect. And so what she did, she wrote J. Edgar Hoover a letter. She sent him a resume. She sent him a recent photograph. And in the letter she said, I've learned from the librarian at Howard University that you have been looking for information about me, because I know and have learned from others that the information you have is incorrect. And this may have been shortly after the Langston Hughes had been called before the committee. Yeah. These were friends of hers. And she said, and I want you to have the right information. And she describes walking to the post office, buying the postage to send this return receipt, signature requested, certified. And she describes how her knees, and her words were, my knees almost buckled under when I put the package in the mailbox. She was afraid, but she felt this was important for her to do. And I just remember McCarthyism just felt different for me. I mean, I've always been appalled and upset by it, but it just became personal for me, reading her personal experience. And of course, Director Hoover wrote back and said, oh no, we weren't looking for you. That may have been some other agency. Well, I've seen the FBI file. You know they were.
They were, yeah.
They had been keeping records on Pauli since her days at Howard, and this was a decade later, so they had a nice little file, most of which was incorrect, as she suspected. Or one agent would write something, and then a couple of years later, they would say they couldn't verify it. So, I mean, just the experiences she had that were just not accessible to me in a real life sense because, you know, it was before my time, really challenged me.
You've spoken more about Polly Murray than about Eleanor Roosevelt.
Yes.
Eleanor Roosevelt is a well-known public figure, a woman of enormous importance in 20th century American history. What did you learn about her that you didn't know before? I know you probably knew a whole lot more about Roosevelt going into this project than you did about Murray.
I had always heard that she was a compassionate person, and the depth of her compassion and the depth of her acceptance of Polly really struck me. I asked Polly's friends who saw them, one in particular, Maida Springer Kemp, who saw Polly and Eleanor together more than anyone other than Malvina Thompson, how did Eleanor deal with Polly? Because, you know, she, as I said, she was impatient. She said what she thought. And Maida said to me, you know, Polly could be embarrassingly direct, but I credit Eleanor Roosevelt with hanging in there with her and being unwilling to allow this young woman to lie out alone, crying in the wilderness. So that was and that was one of the first interviews I did. So that gave me a window into Eleanor Roosevelt's patience with young people, Polly in particular, mm-hmm. and her willingness to listen. I mean, that was the other thing. She appears to be, in social psychology, when we talk about making relationships work, the importance of active listening. Mm-hmm. You couldn't find a more active listener than Eleanor Roosevelt. So she was the ideal active listener, totally accepting of people wherever they were. And so she really opened her home to Polly. She invited Polly up to Valkia for overnight stay. She would invite Polly's aunts. Polly took her significant other to lunch with Eleanor. So her openness. I was also interested in her growth. I guess when I think about this friendship, and I've been talking primarily about Polly, but the same is true of Eleanor in the sense that this friendship was a place of growth for her, so that she moved from being this cautious woman who was trained and socialized to obey the rules. You wait your turn, you work within institutions, to being someone willing to flout the rules. Okay. So I was very impressed with her growth. And a couple of times, there were a couple of instances where it was clear that the relationship with Polly had made discrimination more, it was clear that discrimination wasn't just an abstract concept for her. So that when people talked about housing discrimination because of what she had heard from Polly, because of Harry Belafonte's experience in New York, you could tell from Eleanor's response to that this had become personal for her. You know, later on, I guess feminists talked about politics being personal. It was clear that it became a personal issue for Eleanor. So I was very, very pleased to learn about her compassion from a more personal level, not just from what she did on the political front.
So they related to one another as activists, but also as friends.
Yes, it started out as a confrontation. The friendship started out as a confrontation in words. Polly referred to it as confrontation by typewriter. And it moved from a confrontation to one where they became allies and they began to work around issues together. And then it moved, particularly after FDR died in 1945 and she was no longer First Lady and was freed of the obligation of having to be careful about what she said and advocated because of her responsibilities to the administration. It moved toward a friendship, a genuine friendship.
I want to ask you a question that I didn't speak to you about before, so this is going to come out of, here am I in left side, left field. Were there other similar relationships in either woman's life?
I'll start with Eleanor. Polly wasn't the only African-American friend that Eleanor had. In fact, the friendship with Mary McLeod Bethune was better known. She was also very close friends with Walter White, executive secretary of the NAACP. But Polly argues, and I think I agree with her, that her relationship was different, that her relationship with Eleanor was different because unlike Mrs. Bethune and Walter White, Mr. White, who were age peers of Eleanor's, Polly was a young upstart. And also, they wanted things from her. These are institutional leaders. You know, Mrs. Bethune is president of Bethune-Cookman College. She's president of the National Council of Negro Women. Walter White is executive secretary of the NAACP. So in their dealings with Eleanor, they are thinking about the constituencies, their organizations and their political constituencies. Polly represented no one other than young people like herself. She couldn't deliver votes. You know, Bethune and Walter White could. Mm-hmm. Polly couldn't deliver votes. But she was very brash, and they apparently were afraid to go very far because they were always thinking about the political consequences. It was always calculating. And so Polly believed, and I think she was right, that her relationship was different because in some ways she felt like she had nothing to lose and she could speak her mind. There were other young people, African Americans, that Eleanor had relationships with, and one is Harry Belafonte. They became friends. I don't know if they met at the World's Fair in Brussels, maybe before then, but they became friends. And he still, to this day, speaks of her as his mentor. Uh-huh. I heard him recently speak of her as his mentor. And she showed him a tremendous amount of compassion when he wanted to buy or rent an apartment in an apartment building in New York City and was denied because he was African American. She was so upset. She wrote about it in My Day, and she said, "Why don't you all just come in and move in with me?" And he said, "Well, you know, thank you for the offer." He said, "But I can't. It would be like running away from the battle. You know, I need to fight this." So she had those friendships. And in terms of Polly, I think of two friendships with white women that were really significant. One was with the writer Lillian Smith.
Oh, yes.
Who?
Wait. Do you all know who Lillian Smith is?
Okay. No. Okay. Lillian Smith was a native Southerner born in Georgia. Wrote Killers of a Dream, Strange Fruit, thank you, Nell, which is perhaps is the best known and most important work. Was a early ally of Martin Luther King and Black Civil Rights, that young generation of that era in the 50s and 60s. Never left the South, worked there, started a literary journal, which published one of Polly's first journals, first poems, and was a really important mentor and supporter to Polly, and was one of the persons who read various chapters of Proud Shoes and was very encouraging. So she was important.
And was a lesbian.
And the Second person who comes to mind is a professor of history, a Caroline Ware, who taught at Howard. She was a white woman, social historian. She's another person, I think, who hasn't gotten her due. Social and cultural historian. Became a friend of Pauli's when Pauli enrolled at Howard in law school. And Pauli decided to audit Caroline Ware's American constitutional history course. And they became fast friends. And they were also co-founder. This person also was a co-founder of NOW. And they were friends until Caroline's death. And she also read various segments of Proud Shoes in Draft.
Okay, I want to ask you one last question before we open. And that is, what did you learn yourself for yourself personally?
One of the things I learned is that history is always with us. Pauli was one of those people who carried history around with her so that whenever she was writing letters, and she was forever writing letters to people, she might start the letter by saying, today, 70 years ago, and she'll tell you what happened, and tell you why it's significant in terms of the particular moment. So I found myself taking on that habit. And when I was working on this book, there were several current events happening that reminded me of things that they had gone through. There's a case in the book of a Virginia sharecropper, a black sharecropper who was executed, Odell Waller. And while I was working on the book in my home state, we're not Texas, where they execute more than anybody else, but in Georgia, there was a case, Troy Davis, of a man who was executed, and the victims had recanted. Jimmy Carter had appealed to the parole board. The Pope had gotten involved, but he was still executed. And I can remember Pauli writing when they were dealing with the Odell Waller case of how she didn't sleep the night before. And I wasn't thinking about it as I was advocating and lobbying to the parole board to try to get them to grant clemency for Troy. I mean, I was just one of lots of people in the state and around the world. But I just had a sense of their presence, and Eleanor was lobbying inside of the White House. You know, she was worrying the heck out of Franklin, trying to get him to intervene or to establish a commission of inquiry, which he did not do. And she got on a train and rode down to Virginia to ostensibly to speak to a veterans group, but then she spoke to the governor privately trying to get him to grant clemency. So this notion of history being with us, in some of Pauli's letters could have been written by some of the Black Lives Matter young people. But then, because she burned candles at both ends, I've tried to learn from her life. And she always struggled with this issue of activism and wanting to be an artist. And by that, I mean a writer, a poet. And she also, incidentally, I didn't mention this to you now, dabbled in photography. Uh-huh. And she was kind of an interesting photographer,
I'll
too.
Bet.
And she said to Lillian Smith that I'm really a frustrated writer and I can't get to my work because activism keeps pulling me away. And so from studying her life, I've worked to try to define my activism, because I was a lot like Pauli in terms of activism as a younger woman. Redefine my activism to include writing. So I've learned that. She worked so hard, and so her health suffered. So I've tried to learn the lesson from that about self-care. Mm-hmm. I also remember during that period when I was really trying to study how she dealt with issues of loss and grief, when the two maternal aunts who raised her passed. And I remember going back to that passage a couple of times when I was dealing with my own father's passing. I found comfort in that. So it has, and it's interesting that when I started this book, I was 40, no, let me see.
40-any.
Yeah, 40, 40-something, 41 yeah. or something, and now I'm 65. I'll tell everybody I have my Medicare card now. And I've watched myself age, and I've looked at how she and how Eleanor dealt with aging. I've learned a lot. I mean, it's really like they have been my examples to learn from.
Nice. Nice. Good. Thank you. All right. Now, for you. Yes.
Oh, sorry. Sorry. Thank you, Michelle Deal Winfield. First of all, thank you very much, both of you. You've done something really special for me. I did read the book, and you gave lots of nuggets to really talk about both of those women. And I just want to say, for one, it was about Roosevelt, where she bit off a little ice cream cone. You know, you're going to have fun reading this book, because she throws out all these little nuggets for you. And the fella in the services said he felt like a man. Felt like a man after the first lady bit off his ice cream. You know, because he was now a person. But I wanted to ask the question, which I really think you already answered. But in the book, you talked about her shoulder to shoulder with Wyatt Rustin. And you know, every time it's History Month, they throw it out, all the things he's done, but they never mention Pauline Murray. Mm. So since they don't mention Dr. Murray, and you do mention she's right there with a strategy, right there shoulder to shoulder, I'd like you to tell us again why she's not mentioned.
I think she's not mentioned. Some of it's because she's a woman. Some of it's because she was one who found bureaucracies trying, so that often what Polly would do is make her contribution and then she's on to the next thing. And what is interesting about that is that people were quite willing to take her nuggets, to take her contributions, her ideas, but not always credit her. So I think that is part of it. I also think that the fact that trying to deal with Pauli is not easy, because she is so, she's brilliant, she's complex, she, for some people, seems like a conundrum, in the sense that she is so radical, so brilliant, but she, in fact, I've had people say to me, even some of her friends, I interviewed her age cohort, said that they were just stunned when she decided to go into the priesthood. They were just stunned. They couldn't figure out, how does this fit? But that had always been there. It had always, she had always been devout. I tried to show that some in the book. For example, when she was working with the Odell Walla case, and she wrote him regularly, she would talk to him about, well, remember what Paul wrote. I mean, she would talk to him about the scripture. She would, as a child, would accompany her uncle, who was an Episcopal priest, and he would visit church, go from church to church, and she would go with him, and when the church pianist was not available, she would play the organ. I mean, so that had always been there, but people tend not to see that part of her. So I think some of it's Polly's personality, and some of it is just sexism. Some of it is prejudice against her sexuality. So it's a combination of things. And what's interesting, you bring up Wyatt Rustin, is that he and Polly helped plan, worked with them, helped plan that bus ride into the South. And we hear about it, and we hear about Wyatt's work as the leader of that, but Polly may not get mentioned.
Right behind, right there, yes.
Deborah Gardner, you mentioned Mary McLeod Bethune, yes, who first came to Roosevelt House in 1924 and,
yes,
met all the Roosevelts, Franklin, Eleanor, and Sarah.
Yes.
And obviously the generation before Polly.
Yes.
Would you say that she, in a way, laid the groundwork of a friendship between an African-American woman and a white elite family such as the Roosevelts, so that when Polly came along, Eleanor was already well along that path, and she was able, because she loved young people, that she was notorious, so to speak, for loving young people and certainly encouraging the higher education of young women, that the friendship Mary McLeod Bethune really paved the way for Polly and Eleanor's relationship.
Oh, I would definitely think so, because Eleanor did stay at Mary McLeod Bethune's home, and Polly, whose circumstances were always precarious, didn't have, during Eleanor's lifetime, never owned a home, and so there was never an invitation for Eleanor to go and visit Polly's home. Polly always went to Eleanor's place, and there was never that invitation. I have no doubt that Eleanor would have gone had Polly invited her, no matter what the condition was. But Polly was a very proud person. But Mrs. Bethune and Walter White had middle class standard of living, which Polly didn't. But yes, it was really important. I can't remember where it is that Eleanor writes about how it was a major development for her in terms of her ability to see Mrs. Bethune as a real peer when she hugged her and kissed her. That she crossed a barrier there, and I'm sure that made it possible for her to be more, to have intimate friendships with other young black people.
Yes.
Did Polly challenge Eleanor Roosevelt to confront Franklin Roosevelt on any other issues that were important to the African American population? I mean, do you have documents or letters that show that there was a direct connection between Eleanor's activism and her confrontation of Franklin on these African American issues?
Polly did challenge him on his, what she said, his silence on the issue of lynching. And Eleanor eventually made a statement about how she was against lynching. Polly, when she graduated from Howard at the top of her class, like her male peers, they had expected to be able to go to Harvard. All her male peers had, all those as decorated as she, but she was not allowed to go because she was female. And she didn't really directly ask Eleanor, she just told her, you know, how unfair this was, and Eleanor leaned on Franklin, who was a graduate of Harvard College, to inquire, and he did. He wrote. Now, it's not clear to me if you see the letter, and I have an excerpt of it in the book. It's not clear that Franklin cared about this as much as Eleanor did. In fact, his letter is almost kind of facetious. I think he says something like, I mean, the president was James Conant. He said, now, Jim, I don't want you to think you have to build a new dorm for this young colored lady or something like that. He said, but when you get a chance, would you get one of your deans to write me about this situation? Well, he was going through the motions because Eleanor was leaning on him in Pauli's behalf. So, and she didn't get to go. She ended up going to the University of California at Berkeley, but she did act. You know, she tried to move things where she could. Okay. There's another case I'll just mention of 50 soldiers, I'm sorry, 50 seamen who were court-martialed, and Pauli felt it was really unfair. She was covering the case for the Los Angeles Sentinel, and she was feeding Eleanor material about it, and Eleanor was pressing FDR to do something.
Whether another place where they interacted with one another had to do with crossing between civil rights and human rights. Because in some way, Pauli really shaped the civil rights struggle legally. She was so profoundly involved in that. And Eleanor, likewise, on the human rights struggle. And yet both of them used the other's language. In other words, Eleanor often talked about human rights beginning at home, mm-hmm. here in the United States, and in the same way, I think Pauli was the first person within the government to ever do an assessment of U.S. human rights compliance, mm-hmm. domestically, mm-hmm. and that was like 1947 or something like that. I mean, way ahead. And the two of them, I wonder just, did you find this space where they were both working in between everybody else that gave them a way where they found company? In mm-hmm. a way?
I can remember, it's Pauli's second year of law school. Your question makes me think of this. I don't know if this is an answer, but in 19... This is the second year of Pauli's law school, so this is like 1941. The war is going on. There's this international student assembly, this meeting in Washington, D.C. There are students coming from all over the world. We have students from allied nations there. Pauli and some young radicals from the law school at Howard are delegates. And Eleanor is determined that the students who are from the allied nations feel welcome, feel supported. They get special treatment. They get to spend the night in the White House. But Pauli and her group, and it's not just the students from Howard, there are other radical and progressive white students working with them to raise issues about the allies' behavior in other places in the world. Pauli and her group, they're upset about what's happening in India to the nationalists. They are worried about what the Russians are doing. And they want to raise these questions. And it's so interesting to me because they develop, and this is in the book, they develop a list of resolutions that mirror, the language mirrors some of the language you see Eleanor speak years later. But at this particular moment, Eleanor is rounding up. She corners Pauli at a White House picnic to try to convince her not to move forward with these resolutions because it will upset the allies. But Pauli doesn't back down. The resolutions go forward. They are not approved, but the group stays together. The assembly doesn't fracture because Eleanor tells her one of the things we're worried about is that this will make the allies upset and the students will leave and the assembly will fracture. It doesn't. That's a really important moment for Pauli too, because what it says is, and this is another, I think, important part of the story, this notion of civil dialogue. Don't we need that? The importance of being able to have difficult dialogue and maintain a relationship, whether we're talking on the individual level in terms of friendship, or whether we're talking on a country, on a nation-state level, or whether we're talking institutional. So I began to see this sort of rehearsal between the two of them about how to deal with differences. And in this question, the differences have to do, Paula, that it's the young radicals at this group who were yelling, human rights, human rights. The allies are not behaving well. And Eleanor is saying, shh, shh, shh.
One last question.
Before I invite you all to come upstairs and buy this book and join us for a reception, I just want to say, not to sound presumptuous, but wouldn't Eleanor have been thrilled that this discussion was taking place in her home? And we thank Patricia Bell-Scott and Nell Painter for a really enriching discussion. Please join us upstairs. Thank you.